Magandang umaga. Magandang umaga po sa inyong lahat. Maligayang araw ng Sabado. I'm really happy to be here. It is a privilege to be here and to gather together and worship God. It is really a privilege because God is still giving us an opportunity to worship Him. And this morning, before I start sharing the word of God, I would like to cooperate with you this morning. Since we are in the presence of God, can I first of all see the hand of those who indeed accept that the devil is disturbing many people in the presence of God through the gadget, the cell phones and everything? Can I see the hand of those who believe that through the gadget, people are distracted many times in the church? Can I see the hand? Just the hand. Almost everyone. So if we do believe, I would request you to just put your phone in the flight mode so that we can indeed acquire the word of God, what He has prepared for us this morning. You just put it in the flight mode. If the phone does not have the flight mode, you just switch off so that we'll be able to listen to the word of God. And before that, as I'm praying, I request you to pray for me as well. Pray that God can put the right word in my mouth. Pray that God will speak to you this morning. So this is my prayer, and this is what we're praying right now. Let us pray. Righteous Father, we lift your holy name on high, for you are God, who has made the heaven and the earth with your great power and with your outstretched arms. Although we praise you for being such a great and mighty God, mysterious God that we can't comprehend. We praise you, Father, for the privilege of opening the word of God this morning. Father, it is written in the book of Revelation that blessed is he who reads and those who hear the word of this prophecy and keep the things which are written in them, for the time is near. O Lord, may you speak to us this morning. May you sanctify us through your word this morning. May you rebuke us through your word this morning. May you instruct us through your word this morning. For faith comes only from hearing the word of God. O Lord, we beg of you that every evil force against the word of God this morning be bound in Jesus' name. Lord, may your word inform our mind. May your word indeed touch our heart. And may your word challenge our name. We thank you and bless your holy name. We thank you very much for your Holy Spirit in the midst of us. May you then do something that we never did in our life before. Thank you very much, Father, for listening and answering to our prayer. For we seal this prayer only in Jesus' name. So this morning, we'll be sharing the word of God. And the topic is, start rebuilding the temple. Start rebuilding the temple. This is the topic this morning. And we'll be studying the book of Haggai. Book of Haggai, chapter 1, verse 1 to 11. The book of Haggai, chapter 1, verse 1 to 11. Can you go there so that we can read together and understand together as well? Haggai, chapter 1, verse 1. The Bible says that in the second year of Darius, in the sixth month, on the first day of the month, the word of the Lord came by Haggai the prophet to Zerubbabel, the son of Shealtiel, governor of Judah, and to Joshua, the son of Jehozadak, the high priest, saying, thus speaks the Lord of hosts, saying, this people says, the time has not come, the time that the Lord's house should be built.
Then the word of the Lord came by Haggai the prophet, saying, it is time for you yourselves to dwell in your panel houses, and this temple to lie in ruin.
Now, therefore, thus says the Lord of hosts, consider your ways. In six,
you have sown much and bring in little. You eat, but you are not hard enough. You drink, but you are not filled with drink. You clothe yourselves, but no one is warm. and he who earns wages,
and wages we put into a bargaining hall. 7, thus says the Lord of hosts, consider your ways, go up to the mountains, and bring wood, and build the temple, that I may take pleasure in it, and be glorified. Says the Lord, 9, you look for much, but indeed it came too little. And when you brought it home, I threw it away. Why? Says the Lord of hosts, because of my house that is in ruin, while every one of you runs to his own house. Therefore the heavens above you with all the dew, and the earth with all its fruit. In 11, for I call for a drought on the land
and the mountains, on the grain and the new wine and the oil, on whatever the ground brings forth, on men and livestock, and on all the labor of your hand. I hope you have been reading as well the word of God. He's telling about the people of God as they were saying to themselves that it is not yet the time to build the temple of God. By the way, this time, it is right after the people of God, they came from their exile in Babylon. They were in captivity in Babylon. As God delivered them out of captivity to their province in Judea, as they were in Judea from captivity, this is the time they were saying that indeed it is not yet the time to build the temple of God. And the book of Haggai, Haggai means festival. And as it is written that in the second year, in the sixth month, on the first day, it was the new moon festival. It was during the feast when the word of God came by Haggai the prophet. And it was addressing to the political leader whose name is Zerubbabel, and the religious leader whose name is Joshua the Archites. During the time of the king Darius, that is the first. And this king indeed reigned from 522 BC to 486. He practically reigned for 36 years. So the people of God, as God delivered them out of Babylon, they were in their city. They were saying that it is not yet the time that the Lord's house should be built. It is not yet the time. If you just think of it, the Lord was speaking to them before the Lord speaking to the prophet and telling them what they have to do. Because God speaks to us through His word, He speaks to us through dreams, He speaks to us through advice, He speaks to us through a divine impression. He speaks to us in many ways. So I can see these people, maybe it was through dreams, that the Lord was speaking to them, you need to rebuild the temple. Because the temple was ruined. Why? Because they were in Babylon in captivity. So the Lord was speaking to them in many different ways. The Lord speaks to them their conscience. Take a look at the temple, how it is in the wind. When are you planning to build the temple? When are you planning to rebuild the temple? I can understand you were in captivity in Babylon. That's why the temple was in ruin. But now I have delivered you out of Babylon. You are in your own land. But the temple is in ruin. These people, they stop saying, indeed, it is not yet the time that the Lord's house will be built. This is what they were saying. Not yet the time. It is not yet the time that we should build the temple. But they don't have any plan, by the way. The Bible should be told at least that we will build the temple maybe in the third year. But they don't have any plan. It's not in the third. And instead of saying that, Lord, we will not rebuild the temple, but they will say that it is not yet the time. That is in direct refusal. You know, someone asked, please, can you really sing? The Lord has given us the gift of song, you can sing, but say, I think it's not yet the time for me to save the Lord. Can you just give the opening prayer? No, I think you can ask someone and see it better. Can you share the word of God? No, I'm too late. It's not yet the time. So these people will say that it is not yet the time to build the temple of God. Excuse me.
When they said it is not yet the time to build the temple of God, the Bible says in Greek, they said, then the Lord came by Hagar the prophet, saying, it is time for you yourselves to dwell in your final houses, and this temple will lie in ruin. So in other words, they were focusing on their houses. They were beautifying their houses.
Their houses were so beautiful that they were focusing on the giver.
Now they start worshiping the house.
They say, no, about the temple of God is not yet time. Sometimes, maybe you didn't have a job before. You were unemployed. You were jobless. But when the Lord blessed you with a job, you started taking care of the job so much that you don't have any more time to pray. You don't have any more time to go to church all the time. You don't have any time to win a successful lesson. You don't have any more time to win the word of God. You don't have any more time to pray as far as you worship. Why? Because the Lord has blessed you with a job, expecting that you will serve Him better.
These people, they start believing it's not yet the time.
But they are just beautifying their houses. I don't know if it happened with you, maybe in your eyes. The Lord has allowed you to give you that intelligence. You are able to pass this, and then you spend time with God, and you spend time with God.
I have a lot of time, can I spend time with God now? But remember that it is the Lord who has blessed you with those studies that privilege to study as well.
So these people, they say it is not yet the time that the Lord's house should be built. You know, any time we start prioritizing something more than God, there is something that is waiting for us. The Bible says that the Lord said, you consider your ways. You consider your ways, it is repeated in verse 5 and in verse 7. God says, you consider your ways. Remember that He delivered you out of Babylon so that they can come and worship me. But now, instead of worshiping the gift that I bless you with, you need to consider your ways. You remember when God delivered Israel out of Egypt? As Moses went to Pharaoh, he said to him that the God of Israel is the leader of my people so that they worship me in the wilderness. So the main purpose of why God delivered them is to worship him. They didn't have any time to worship God. In the same way, when they were in Babylon, they didn't have that time to commune with God. But they delivered them out of Babylon, and in their life, these people say it's not yet the time that we should build the temple of God. You remember Romans 12:5 tells us we are one body in Christ. We are one body in Christ, we are members of the body of Christ. And these people, as the members of the body of Christ, we need to have a temple where we worship God. As a church, as the whole church, we need to have a specific place where we worship God. You remember in Genesis, because of sin, God kicked out Adam and Eve out of the Garden of Eden. But God longs so much to be with us. He longs so much, then in Exodus 25:8, he said, let them make a sanctuary that we may dwell among them.
The Lord desires to be with us always.
Let them make a sanctuary that I may dwell among them. But these people, instead of making the sanctuary that the Lord may dwell among them, but these people start to find their houses. They forget about God. So sad. It is so sad. And God said, you need to consider your ways. Go with me in 6. In 6, the Bible says, you have sown much and bring in little. You have sown much and bring in little. You eat, but you don't have enough. You drink, but you are not filled with drink. You broke yourself, but no one is warm. And you end wages, put into a bag with balls. It was the blowing of the trumpet. The people of God were going to divine judgment. If you read in Jeremiah 29, I think it is 5. When the Lord wrote the letter and brought up in Babylon to the people of God who were in captivity, he said, go and build the houses. Go and be people to thrive
in Babylon.
Then they came up with the same mind. They started building their houses again, over and over again, and not looking at what the people of God needs to be. And they were going to divine judgment. The Lord said, you are so much,
but bringing so little. You're bringing little.
You eat, but you are not have enough.
Come on.
You drink,
and you are not filled with drink.
You clothe yourself, but no one is warm. And you always put into a bag with balls.
This is the problem of the trumpet.
Because the things to make the world, they were going to this divine judgment.
They are trying to do so well in the city so they can immediately reap a lot, but they bring so little.
They were eating, they were not eating, they were still hungry, by the way.
They were drinking, but they are still thirsty.
This is what they were going to do. It was the blowing of the trumpet. Because they didn't build the temple of God. You know, when these people, they were stubborn, this is what they were going through. I don't know if you're also feeling somewhere. It might be the blowing of the trumpet. Something that you used to do before, and it used to be prosperous. It used to be successful. Maybe you have your own business. And you know how you started your own business, how it was so successful, but after some time, you started getting trouble. The income comes so little. You don't have any more profit. You need to consider your ways. You need to consider your ways.
Maybe you used to have good grades as a student.
You are studying and you need to have very good grades, but after some time, you are spending time, you know, studying you are reviewing your lessons, you are reviewing your lessons, you study so hard so that you can have at least that high grade, I can say so. But when the piece comes, it's like you just forgot the thing that you're studying. And then when they give you back the exam paper or quiz paper, your brain is just so, I study a lot for this subject, but how long can I get so? This brain, I don't really deserve it. No. Because the time that I spent studying is so long that I didn't even
expect you to have this kind of brain. The Bible says this morning, you need to consider your ways.
Maybe before when you get into a relationship, in marriage relationship, everything was so sweet, everything was so good. Though you may be going to challenges in the marriage, but you were able to still fix it because you were working with God. But after some time, conflict after conflict. You don't understand one another. The house is in conflict. And the Bible says this morning, you need to consider your ways. I don't know what you are going through, but this morning, the Bible is telling that we need to consider our ways. In other words, we need to introspect. We need to examine ourselves. How was my relationship with God before, and how is it now? These people, they say, it is not yet the time that the Lord house should be built.
There is, but they are still hungry.
For me, I cannot even. I would rather not eat. If the food is not enough, I would rather not eat.
Because if I eat, I'm still hungry. It's so disappointing, someone. I drink some food, I'm so thirsty, but I drink, but I'm still thirsty. I would rather not drink.
I remember when I was a child, when we are invited to a party, what my mom used to do is she would cook something to eat. Because she said that in case, if the food in the party is not enough, but at least ate something before you go there.
I really like that idea of my mom.
So you go eat something before you go to any place that you are invited.
So once I eat, of course, either the food is enough or not enough, but I have already something in my stomach.
But if people were going to this bad judgment,
I can see other people maybe,
they were admiring them. When they look at their houses, they say, wow, it's so beautiful, they have beautiful and luxurious houses. But what the people are going through is just so sad. It's just so, they were going through sorrowful experience. The bitter experience.
People outside can see them that they are putting their food, they can smile, but what they are going through in their houses is just so much they cannot handle it. But when they see everything is good, they can smile, they are studying, they are studying, but the problem is they are waiting, but the salary is even much higher, but it's just like they are putting the salary in the bag of balls.
They know they still have the basis, but it's all balls in the salary, and they cannot have the salary. The money is gone. They do not study, but they are so dumb. What is happening, God? The Lord is telling this morning that we need to consider our ways. You need to consider your ways.
They eat, but they are still hungry. By the way, before they should eat anything else, they should first eat the word of God. And the word of God is found in the sanctuary.
How can I eat the word of God if the house of God is in need? The word of God is found in the sanctuary. The temple is in ruin. They don't like eating the word of God. And if you don't eat the word of God first, anything else that you can eat will leave you unsatisfied. You will still be hungry. You will still be thirsty. You know, it's just so sad. They eat, but they still don't have enough.
They drink, but they still don't feel filled with drink.
They clothe themselves, but no one is home. They pay wages, they are working so hard. They are swimming, they are doing farming, but it's just so little because it doesn't satisfy. And the Bible tells us in Isaiah 5:16 that we need the time for the days of God. They were postponing the time to bring the temple to God. Whereas they know anything about the future. When the Lord impresses to do what is right, we cannot do that immediately. Because what is that postponing? When it comes, when the Lord comes, For the second time, you will say, Lord, I was doing this and that, but you tell us you did not rebuild the temple. You did not do what I was telling you to do. We need to be very careful. It is God who is the master of time. Once he tells us to do so, we need to do it. Redeeming the time for the days are evil. So because of their selfish priority or so focused, it leaves them hungry, thirsty, and painless. It was so sad. You know what the Bible tells us about in Romans, that everything works together for good to those who love God. Many times I hear people say about that. All things work together for good to those who love God. When people are going through trials and challenges of life, Many people quote this verse. All things work together for good to those who love God.
But my question this morning is, do you love God?
Does your lifestyle tell the world that you love God? Does the way you're treating your neighbors tell the world that you really love God? Because to love God is the deepest commandment. Jesus said in John 14:15 that if you love me, Keep my commandment, and in Deuteronomy 28, there is the blessing of obedience.
It's just amazing, this chapter.
In Deuteronomy 28, there are blessings for obedience. Those who obey God, there are blessings, and there are also curses for disobedience. These people, they are disobeying God. That's
presence went out, it was the blowing of the trumpet.
The Lord is indeed calling our attention to come back to him. It is the blowing of the trumpet. When we can see in the book of Job
was going through trials, Job was going through the temptations, but indeed
Job was still able to overcome. There are two cases.
When you are going through challenges and trials in life, things become so hard that you can't understand.
There are two cases that we need to understand. You are either going astray. You are either going astray. You are either forsaking God in your life, or you are either getting close to God. But what that I know you are the prophet of your life. When you are going through, the marriage relationship does not work out anymore. Your studies are not working out anymore. You are trying to do your best to get, but nothing is working out.
You are either going astray,
or you are either getting closer to God. But you are the prophet of your life. And if you are going astray, is the Lord blowing up the trumpet, saying, you need to come back to me. You need to come back to me. But if you are indeed getting close to God, as the Bible says, for those who are in the garden life shall suffer persecution. If you are indeed getting close to God, it is evidence that I am walking with God.
But if you are not, you can realize, you can examine your life, you can look back.
How was I before, and how am I now?
If you just look at, no, I don't have any more devotional. I don't see the word of God anymore. I don't listen to people anymore. I don't even see people anymore.
So the Lord is blowing the trumpet, telling you you need to come back to me.
You need to come back to me.
The Bible says they are not filled with drink.
This reminds me of the Samaritan woman recorded in the book of John 4. The Samaritan woman was going to the well and drawing water.
So he was going to the well at 12 noon.
He was going there to draw water because first of all, the Samaritan woman was ashamed to go there in the morning while everyone is there because she was a prostitute. So she was going there while indeed there is no one.
So she will go and draw water and come back to his house. She will go and draw water. But one day, she was thinking that, well, I'm going to draw water, thinking that I will not find anyone,
because first I find people they might be indeed laughing at me, because they know that I am a prostitute, I had five husbands before, and the one that I have now is not mine. So she was going,
went to the well at 12 noon. And as she was going there, thinking that there was no one, but there was someone so special,
someone who can give indeed, can give that living water.
As she went to the well, she finds someone. Jesus of Nazareth.
It's an amazing story. As Jesus was asking the drink from the Samaritan woman, she said, you are a Jew. How come that you're asking me a drink?
Jesus said, if you knew the gift of God, and who is asking you to give me a drink, you should ask him the drink for he gives you the living water.
Okay, as the conversation continues, Jesus said, the water that I shall give, it shall spring up in the everlasting. Let us read that. It's amazing. Let's go to John 4.
In John 4, John chapter 4, I really like the word of Jesus. It's amazing. John chapter 4, verse 13.
Jesus answered and said to her, whoever drinks of this water will thirst again.
But whoever drinks of the water that I shall give him will never thirst. But the water that I shall give him will become in him a fountain of water, springing up into everlasting life. So this woman started understanding the reason the water, once I drink of it, I shall never thirst. The water that Jesus alone can give, the living water. This woman said, sir, give me this water, so that I may not thirst again, and neither I may not come in this place. The living water. If only once you are drinking the living water, you will be satisfied. The living water will indeed make you filled Any other water, you will not be filled with it. As Jesus said as well in John 17:37, he said, on the last day, that bread day of the peace, Jesus stood and cried out, saying, if anyone thirsts, let him come to me and drink. He who believes in me, as the scripture says, out of his heart will flow rivers of living water. In 39, he said about this, but this is spoken concerning the Spirit, whom those believing in him would receive, for the Holy Spirit was not yet given, because Jesus was not yet glorified. The people of God, they were waiting for divine judgment. That's why, once they eat, they are still hungry. They drink, they are still thirsty. They throw themselves, but no one is home, because they are dead. They were not calling themselves in the righteousness of Jesus. They were eating, but no one was going to divine judgment. The Lord was calling their attention, but they didn't want to listen. Therefore, they were going through this. It was so hard for them. People can see them, that they are living a satisfying life, but what they are going through, it is just so sad. I don't know if you are going through the same experience in these last days of this. Consider your ways. That's the reason why you can be having some wages, but indeed, there is disappointment, there is failure, there is disappointment over and over again. So the money that you are receiving, you start using them for the sickness, for many things happening in the family. God is saying this morning that you need to consider your ways. You need to consider your ways. You know, the church, as the Acts of the Apostles, page 9, paragraph 1, the prophet said the church is God's appointed agency for the salvation of men. It was organized for service, and its mission is to carry the gospel to the world. This is the mission of the church, to carry the gospel message. The church is for the salvation of men. And here we see that the church was ruined. How can it be the salvation of men when it is ruined? There is no prophetic sense, there is no candlestick, there is no, the church is, there is nothing to prophesy. How can they then carry the gospel message? And the Lord telling them, indeed, you need to consider your ways. You need to rebuild the temple, because the temple is in ruin. I have called you so that you root out the old world. But how come that you are indeed neglecting the temple of God? You are neglecting the temple of God. The temple of God is ruined. As indeed the high priest Joshua and the governor of Zerubbabel, as they went to see the people, the people indeed examined, they introspected themselves, and they perceived that indeed the temple of God is ruined, and we need to build it.
We need to build the temple of God.
And as the church, you know, the word church comes from Greek word, which means ecclesia. And ecclesia means outdoor. Ecclesia means community or group of people. So we are called out of darkness into the light of God. We are called out of the world into his light so that we can carry the gospel message. But if the temple is in ruin, how can we carry the gospel message? We are all members of the body of Christ. As the church members, we need to be rebuilt as well. We need to be one as well. We need to be united. There are some churches, people are coming to church, but people indeed are conflicting among themselves. The people that does not love, does not know
And pray and seek my face
and turn from their wicked ways. I will forgive their sins, I will heal their land.
The land was sick.
That's why they sow a lot of seed, but they bring in so little.
Why? Because the land was sick.
Because the land was sick, they brought in so little, therefore they eat, but they are still hungry.
Because the land was sick, they bring in so little, they drink, but they are still thirsty.
Because the land was sick, they were not satisfied with either drinking, because the land was sick.
The land was sick, because it was indeed profitable for them to be sick,
so that they can come back to God.
When they were in Babylon, ask the Bible, that indeed, make garden, you plant garden, you indeed build houses.
Maybe it was even more successful than they had in their own province.
Because the land was sick.
What is sick in your life?
Are you going to do something by just wake up? But if you wake up, what is sick in your life?
It is the marriage relationship.
It is your job, you're working so hard, but the salary has become so little.
What is sick in your life?
You are the prophet of your life. You know your life very well. And what is sick in your life? The Lord wants to heal your life this morning, but he needs to know what is sick in your life. Because if it is fine with me, it will not be healed.
What is sick in your life?
This is the remedy. Bible says,
if my people, which are called by my name, they shall humble themselves and pray.
And turn from their wicked ways. I will hear from heaven, I will forgive their sins, and heal their land.
So before they pray, they need to humble themselves, they need to see, yes, indeed, I have been prioritizing my life more than I am prioritizing my walk with God.
I've been prioritizing my job more than I am prioritizing my walk with God.
I've been prioritizing my children more than I'm prioritizing my devotional. I've been prioritizing the people around me than the relationship that I have with God.
The Bible says, if we shall first of all, before we pray, humble yourself, examine your life, do that introspection, what is sick in your life, and as we humble ourselves,
The Lord will show us how great He is and how far we went from where we have been, far from Him. And then we will bring us back.
What is sick in your life? Examine your life.
We need to humble ourselves. And then we need to pray.
Humble yourself and pray.
And besides praying, you need to seek my face. Through the word of God, we need to seek God through this word.
We need to spend time with Him. Lord, please search me, O God, and know my heart.
Search me, O God, and know my thoughts.
And if there is any wicked way, Lord, lead me in the way everlasting.
Search me, O God.
We need to humble ourselves.
We need to pray.
We need to see where my relationship was before, and how am I working with God now?
Because Jesus is coming again very soon.
It is His desire to be with people forever. But before we get there, we need to reconcile with Him.
We need to start prioritizing things which will not contribute to our everlasting life.
We need to start prioritizing things which are temporary and start prioritizing things which are everlasting.
What is sick in your life?
These people of God, they are wicked ways.
You know, these people of God, they are wicked ways where they didn't build the temple, they were just staying there, building houses,
they didn't build the people of God, that will be a wicked way.
I don't know what is your wicked way. You know it very well. There are some on social media for five and six hours. But when it's not devotional, we are just rushing. We are just rushing. The Bible is telling us this morning, we need to consider our ways. We need to humble ourselves. We need to pray. We need to seek God first through the word of God.
And besides, we need to turn from the wicked ways.
We are very good at confessing our sins. And I'm very sure right now the Holy Spirit is speaking to you for the things that you are doing which are not glorifying God.
And it says this morning that we need to turn away from it.
We are so very good at confessing sin.
Some people can even cry. Oh Lord, forgive me for wasting time. Lord, forgive me for prioritizing other things. Than you are prioritizing you. They can even cry. But when they get out of their knees, they are still doing the same. But the Bible is telling us this morning that after humbling ourselves, after praying, after seeking God first, the fourth is that we need to turn from our way.
Then God will heal the land. I don't know if it is the land of marriage which is sick.
I don't know if it is the land of your studies which is sick. I don't know if it is the land of your job which is sick. I don't know which land in your life is sick. But the Bible is telling us this morning that we need to humble ourselves. We need to look at God from now on. I will be indeed prioritizing you. Indeed, I can see how my life has been deteriorating because of prioritizing things of this world. But the Bible tells me that I am not of this world, but I've been living as if I am of this world. You have called me out of darkness into light, but even if I am in light, I'm still living as the world. I speak as the world speaks. I mean, my lifestyle does not show the people that I am the child of God. I don't pray enough. I don't pray the word of God. It's just boring. I don't pray. It's only when someone visits me in the church of pastor, then I can pray for me. I don't know. It's just I've been processing things which are not worthy for the glory of God. If it is your desire, indeed the Lord has been speaking to you. I am very sure the Lord has been speaking to you. You could see where you have been falling down. You could see where you indeed forsook the first love that you had for God. You can see it 3 years ago, 2 years ago, 5 years ago. The way you were serving God, is it still the same as you are serving God now? You can see how you have fallen short to the glory of God. And this morning, it is the blowing of the trumpet. The Lord is saying, you need to come back to me. You need to humble yourself this morning. You need to indeed pray. You need to seek my face. You need to turn away from your wicked ways. If it is your desire, Lord, I can see how my business was not successful. I can see how I was quarreling with my husband, with my wife over and over again. I can see sickness. This is in my family. Nothing is working out in my family. And this morning, as I have heard your voice, and you have blessed me much harder than my heart, I would like to commit myself once again to God. I would like to commit myself once again to God. I would like to start again, even that relationship, that communion that I used to have with you. Because this world, the business of this world, has taken me away from your presence. I can feel it, Lord. I don't have any relationship with you. But this morning, Papa, I would like to indeed be reconciled with you once again. Because we are doing the day of atonement. Jesus is coming again very soon. His coming is very sure, and he wants us to be reconciled once again. He wants us to come back to our first love. He wants us to have that desire to spend time with him. If it is your desire, You say, Lord, from now on, help me, O God. Grant me your sufficient grace that I may stand once again for you. I'll request you to stand up. If it is your desire, Lord, I have been neglecting you many times. But this time, I have heard your voice, and I would like to stand for you.
because this world is not my world. I'm not of this world. Lord, I would like to be, to come back to you again. If it is your desire, I request you to stand up. If it is your desire, I request you to stand up and we'll seek God in prayer together. If it is your desire, Lord, this morning, I want to humble myself. Lord, this morning, I want from now on to start seeking your face. Oh Lord, this morning as I heard your voice, I would like to start seeking you as I used to do. I used to fast and pray. I used to indeed sharing the word of God. But it's time I keep on falling into temptations over and over again because I don't seek your face anymore. If it is your desire, I request you to stand up as we are praying together. Let us pray. Righteous Father, we praise you. And we lift your holy name on high for being God who never change. Forgive us, Father, for where we change this. Forgive us, Father, and have mercy upon us. Where we didn't prioritize you in our life anymore. Have mercy upon us for the lack of unity as a church. Have mercy upon us for the lack of love as a church, Lord. We plead and we beg of you, may you cleanse us. May you purify us, Lord. We beg of you in the name of Jesus. Purify our mind. Help us to come back to the first love, Lord. We plead and we pray, may you fill us with your Holy Spirit. May you increase our hatred for sin. Remind us always, oh God, that our desire is not ours. Please, Father, increase our love for you and our love around us. Help us to grow as a church. Help us to be rebuilt once again as a church. Help us to be one and to carry the gospel message. Oh, Father, we pray for the Holy Spirit in the midst of us. We thank you very much for your grace. We thank you for your grace, Lord. We thank you for being such a great and mighty God. Thank you for speaking to us, Lord. And do not let the devil snatch out what we have learned from you this morning. We thank you very much, Father, for being so gracious. For fixing our lives this morning. Thank you, Father, for listening and answering to our prayer. We pray all of this in Jesus' name. Amen.